Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell is sponsored by Equity Resource, a development, construction, and investment firm that is transforming properties throughout the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. Our mission is to develop properties at a high level of value, a low risk of investment, while providing impeccable service to our customers. When you're ready to sell, renovate, or invest in a property, choose Equity Resource. Call us today at 202-621-6632 or visit our website, equityresource.net.
Good morning and welcome to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. Now for today's show, here's attorney Ethel Mitchell.
Good morning and welcome. I am your host, attorney Ethel Mitchell. Welcome to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. Welcome to all who are listening live throughout the world on lawtalkwithethelmitchell.com, WLDCnews.com, and over Radio 1 Station 1450 AM. Happy Valentine's Day to everyone. Happy Valentine's Day. For many years, I lived in the Caribbean, and during Valentine's Day, all women wore red. You could be 80 years old and you would have your red on. So I'm telling all the women out there to put on their red and strut your stuff and have a great Valentine's Day. We have a wonderful program for you today about love and law. Our guests are just marvelous. We have Dr. Audrey Chapman and attorney Michelle C. Thomas, who's going to discuss some hot topics. So you think you are in love, but are you ready for the twists and turns? Call us if you have questions or comments at 1-800-450-7876. That's 1-800-450-7876. This program is brought to you by my law office, Wills and Trust, LLC, where I prepare wills, trust, power of attorneys, and advanced medical directives. If you or someone you know needs a will or a trust, call me at 202-772-1988. That's 202-772-1988. We're going to go straight on into introducing the guest today. Let me give you the call-in number because I want everyone to really enjoy this program, but I, of course, have to remind you that what you hear on the program is only for information. No attorney-client relationship is established by anything said on this program. Each person's circumstances are different, and you must seek individual counsel for any situation for which you need legal advice. Stacy is standing by at 1-800-450-7876. That's 1-800-450-7876. So call us or tweet us at LawTalkEM. According to the most recent census, there are 45 million black people in the United States. Among black households, 45.7% are married couples. In the entire United States, the median age for first marriages in 2013 was 26 years of age for women and 29 for men. 68.6% of people were married at some point in their lives. 74% of women and 77% of men in their first marriages make it to their 10th anniversary. 19% of men and women were married twice. 5.3% have been married three or more times. The median length of a first marriage that ends in divorce is 8 years. And the time between divorce and a second marriage is on the average of about 3.8 years. So with that in mind, we're going to talk to relationship expert extraordinaire, Dr. Audrey Chapman, our wonderful, wonderful own Dr. Audrey Chapman from right here in Washington, D.C. And we have attorney Michelle Thomas. They're going to discuss with us, so you think you are in love, but are you ready for the twists and turns? We're going to explore love, law, and relationship matters for those who are single, engaged, married, widowed, or looking to date, including some special consideration for seniors. Let me first tell you a little about both of our guests. Dr. Audrey Chapman is a family therapist, author, trainer, and nationally known relationship expert. She has developed a tough love approach to helping men and women develop loving, interdependent relationships, build communication, and take responsibility for their happiness. She has appeared on dozens of national and television programs, including Oprah, Phil Donahue, 2020, Sally Jesser Raphael, Maury Povich, BET's Tavis Smiley, Good Morning America, NPR's Morning Edition, and many, many more. She's been featured in the Washington Post, Essence Magazine, the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, Ebony, and others, and most recently featured on the TV One Roland Martin show. Audrey is a therapist in private practice in Washington, D.C., and has authored several best-selling relationship books, including 7 Attitude Adjustments for Finding a Loving Man, Getting Good Loving, How Black Men and Women Can Make Relationships Work, Man-Sharing, Choice or Dilemma, A Radical New Way of Relating to the Men in Your Life, Entitled to Good Loving, Black Men and Women and the Battle for Love and Power. As a former host of the Audrey Chapman Show for 28 years, Audrey conducted weekly live interviews with expert celebrity guests on romantic problems and answered relationship questions from live callers. Attorney Michelle C. Thomas is a noted divorce strategist and the founder of M.C. Thomas & Associates, a premier divorce and family law firm serving Washington, D.C., Maryland, and Virginia. Ms. Thomas focuses on complex divorce litigation, high net worth divorce, and contested cases for traditional and non-traditional families. She has extensive experience skillfully protecting assets through prenuptial and postnuptial agreements, post-separation planning, and aggressive litigation as necessary. She is a recipient of numerous awards and belongs to many legal organizations. She's an elected member of the D.C. Bar Board of Governors. She was recognized by the National Bar Association as a top 40 lawyer under 40 in 2014 and has been named to the 2015 top 100 black lawyers list. Dr. Thomas has provided expert advice or been seen in Essence and other magazines on various divorce-related topics. She's appeared on broadcast radio programs, including The Audrey Chapman Show and here on Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. She was our inaugural guest. So welcome to both of you. Welcome,
Thank
Dr.
you.
Chapman.
Thank you. We're very happy to be here. I'm happy to be here. And welcome, Michelle, also.
Yes. Hi, Audrey. Good to hear from you again.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
Yeah.
For having us, and congratulations on your 1 year.
Our 1 year anniversary. Yes, we made it to 1 year. Thank you. Now let's get into the topic at hand on Valentine's Day, love. Okay, Audrey, when you and I spoke,
right,
you indicated that you might be able to look at following categories of people, sort of by age in a way. There was the young, never married hopefuls, the married, the divorced, and then the seniors. Can you explain a little more about how you can maybe look at people and where they are in their lives and the relationship issues that they face, please?
Well, there are basic things that people face no matter what age they're in as it pertains to relationships, and I'll tell you what that looks like in a minute. There's something called marital happiness predictors. And there's a way to determine whether people have what they need to even create a happy union in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're, yeah.
Okay.
If you're, you know, when you first start out, probably the first set of relationships you have maybe are in daycare.
Okay.
And then you go into grade school and you have another set. And that maybe be a little bit more involved because it's classroom stuff, but it's also playing with kids out on the schoolyard, and maybe it's organizational stuff that you have to do. And then eventually you get into high school, and people, because of what's going on, just, you know, both in the biological sense and the social sense, people are wanting to have more special and, in a way, kind of isolated relationships. Then you get to college. where people are supposed to be focus on, obviously, career and stuff like that. But often that's when people start thinking about how to have a more one-on-one kind of relationship. And, of course, then you get into young adulthood. If you've matured throughout all of those developmental years, and that's a key issue, you are then getting yourself ready to think more about a one-on-one relationship with a life partner. It's at that point that people find themselves running into difficulty if they don't have the tools and the skills that the predictors say you should have. Do you want me to describe what those...
Yeah, what are those tools? If you can just, you know, shortly tell us what they are.
I will. I'll be brief. The first one is compatibility skills. You have to have compatibility skills with the person that you are involved with. In other words, you look for the balance of similarities and differences between the two of you in terms of personality, values, how you interact with each other. In other words, do you fit together? Are you a good fit is what I always look for. The second one is relationship skills, and most people think the second one has to be the first one. But compatibility has to be the first one.
Okay.
Relationship skills is communication, being able to active listening, which means that you're not always talking over the person or being defensive when you're listening to what they're saying. You're able to really take in what they're trying to tell you. Being open and honest, and here are the important ones, having the skills for conflict management, to be able to negotiate tools, and to have the ability to affirm and acknowledge what the other person is sharing with you.
Okay.
The third one is, what kind of patterns have you had all along with friends, lovers, colleagues, etc.? In other words, if you've had a pattern of short-term connections with people, you don't stay with people very long, or you're not very honest with people, or you have a very kind of tense and conflictual relationships with people, then, and that's your pattern, you're not going to be able to bring off a very stable and happy situation. And four, family patterns and background. And this is a really big one. When I have someone come in the office, particularly couples, I pay a lot of attention to the family patterns. Because if you've grown up in a household where you, first of all, have never even seen two people relate together, negotiate, work through issues, and also a demonstration of being loving, then you're clueless. And if you've gone through life and all the people around you haven't either, you really are at a loss. So family background and the patterns of how people relate, the quality of the parents' marriage, how they express affections, emotions, what kind of level of intimacy they're able to share, those are the things. And the last one is your character and your conscientious traits, your emotional health, your self-awareness. A lot of people aren't aware of their own issues. They really aren't. Your personality and the maturity of your consciousness. Those are the five key areas that you have to be aware of, and you at least need to be trying to address and pull together as you move through life. And some people don't get there until they're 40. Some people don't get there until they're 50. And sometimes people don't get there until they're 50 and they realize that all of these areas are in a deficit. And that's when they come in for counseling, or they attend some kind of a program or something where they can start working on themselves.
Wow, that's interesting, because it almost doesn't matter what your age is or what your marital status is when it comes to, you know, these kind of skills and tools that it talks about, that you're talking about. Is that so, or is there a difference between, you know, somebody who's never been married or somebody who is married?
No. It developmentally, you wouldn't have all these five areas at, let's say, 16 or at 18. You probably wouldn't. But if you are a 35-year-old, 40-year-old, 50-year-old, you should have most of this at least in progress or in pretty good shape. And if you don't, it's not the end of the world. You have to know that you don't, and be willing to get it together. And what a lot of people do, which is why I wrote the book Getting Good Loving, Seven Ways to Find and Make Love Last, people get hooked up with another person because they want them to have all of these areas together for them. I called it entitlement syndrome.
I see.
So I don't have my act together, but I'm going to hook up with you because you look like you have yours together, and therefore I'm going to be able to have the kind of relationship I want and make love work and whatever. Well, it doesn't work that way.
Wow. Okay, we have to take a break right now, and when we come back, we're going to talk a little more about this and then get Michelle here in to talk about the legal part of this. Thank you. We'll be right back.
Is power. It's now open, St. John's Kitchen, 5315 East Capitol Street, Southeast. It's soul food cooking at its best. Stop by today and get some liver and onions, pig feet, fish, meatloaf, chitlins, mac and cheese, collard greens, and so much more. And they're open for breakfast, too, with salmon cakes, scrapple, and pancakes, and you have to get a slice of that sweet potato pie. Open 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., St. John's Kitchen, soul food at its finest. 202-575-2826.
Musicians, right now during Guitar Center's President's Day sale, save up to 60% off the best selection of guitars, drums, keyboards, DJ, and more. Deals like a Mitchell acoustic guitar, now just $99. Three pairs of Vic Firth X5 Day drumsticks for just $12. Or a Harbinger 4-channel PA for just $169. Plus, grab your copy of The List, featuring hundreds of deals so good we can't advertise them. Or create a deal with a cash-saving coupon from GuitarCenter.com. Don't miss the savings this President's Day weekend at Guitar Center.
Welcome back to The Dog Show. Up next, we have Satchmo. Satchmo is a member of the Shelter Pet Group.
That's right, a group known especially for their couch-snuggling, ball-chasing, face-licking, tail-wagging, backyard-hanging, and, of course, companionship.
And what breed would you say Satchmo is?
I'd have to go with maybe a lavish terrier-hound-chihuahua-looking kind of mix.
Tremendous dog.
I'd also like to point out Satchmo's coloring, a white, gray, brown, black brindle. Simply marvelous.
You know, it's such a treat to watch a dog like this.
Now, let's see him in action.
Look how he makes eye contact with his person.
That's actually known as the treat stare.
How intuitive. And now he appears to be excitedly turning in circles.
Ah, the happy dance, so common with this group.
And finally, the loving face lick.
It's great how he just gets in there and, well, licks.
Fantastic. But really, the best way to know an amazing shelter pet like Satchmo is to meet one.
Visit theshelterpetproject.org today. Adopt.
Brought to you by Maddie's Fund, the Humane Society of the United States, and the Ad Council.
Who might you save?
Your mother, your father, your husband, uncle, aunt, son.
Learn FAST, F-A-S-T, the sudden signs of a stroke, and you could save...
Your friend, your best friend, teacher, boss, coach.
F, face drooping. A, arm weakness. S, speech difficulty. T, time to call 911. F-A-S-T, face, arm, speech, time. That's F, face drooping, A, arm weakness, S, speech difficulty, T, time to call 911. The sooner they get to the hospital, the sooner they'll get treatment, and that can make a remarkable difference in the recovery of...
Your neighbor, the waiter, a fellow shopper, a total stranger, grandmother, grandfather.
So learn FAST, the sudden signs of a stroke, then pass it on, because you never know who might save you.
Your wife, your colleague, teammate... Mother.
Spot a stroke fast. Visit strokeassociation.org. Brought to you by the American Stroke Association and the Ad Council.
You don't usually get a stock tip from a 16-year-old, but I'm here to tell you about a different kind of stock. It's called Better Futures. A stock for social change that's not about making money. Instead, you invest to help students like me go to college. This is beyond a simple donation. It's the opportunity for America to invest in its kids and take an active stake in the future of the country. The return on your investment isn't money. What you get back is knowing you protected our potential. So one day, that potential can grow up to become surgeons and architects, executives and engineers, people who can change the future just by being a part of it. My name is Alicia, and I am your dividend.
Invest in better futures with UNCF. Visit uncf.org/invest. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
but a wonderful thing to invest in. A public service announcement brought to you by UNCF and the Ad Council.
News Talk 1450 WOL AM, where information is power.
Welcome back. You are listening to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. And we just finished hearing an amazing and wonderful series of predictors for marital success and just really great information from Dr. Audrey Chapman. Michelle, Attorney Michelle C. Thomas is with us, and I'd like you to chime in here with this discussion. Michelle, please join us.
Yeah, no, I think all of the tools that Audrey laid out are really important. I would also say that love has a practical side as well, right, and a legal side. And there are so many legal implications to people deciding to tie the knot. So you really have to be prepared from that perspective as well. You know, everybody hears the old adage, you know, love don't cost a thing. Nothing could be further from the truth.
Oh,
if
my.
You don't properly prepare and plan, love could cost you your house, your car, your hard-earned assets, your business. And so, you know, in addition to doing all the proper premarital counseling, whether it's with therapists or pastors, you might want to consider speaking with a lawyer about making sure that you're protecting what you've worked so hard for, particularly now that people are getting married later and later in life. Mm-hmm. It's really important to take those steps. Perhaps consider a prenuptial agreement if love has gotten that serious for you. So, you know, to answer your first question, is love enough? It's really not enough. And I think the divorce statistics can speak to that point. Yeah. If it were enough, there would be a whole lot less divorce going on.
Yeah, that's true.
So there are a lot of things you need to consider before you actually say I do.
Tell me just a little bit, and then I want Audrey to chime back in here. Tell us a little bit about what is a prenup, because a lot of people don't know. And is there such a thing as a postnup also?
There is such a thing as a postnup. But first, a prenup is essentially a contract entered into by two people in contemplation of getting married. So you can actually meet with a lawyer or speak to someone about it and decide, you know, who's going to pay the bills or which income is separate property or marital property. Are you going to share everything, or is everything going to remain separate property? But essentially, for people to sort of grasp it, I say a prenup is insurance, right? If you don't buy or drive a car without insurance or a house without insurance,
I remember you
said
that.
Why in the world would you get married without insurance?
So that's the most important relationship in the world.
That's the most important relationship. It can make or break you at any given point in time. So a prenuptial agreement is really something that lays out sort of a roadmap for how your assets and your money and everything will be divided if, in fact, it comes to that point. Mm-hmm. Now, the goal, of course, is that you sign a prenup, you put it away, and you forget it exists.
Mm-hmm.
But at the point that you're contemplating divorce, you'll be so glad that you have
it. That you have it, yeah.
And a postnup, now that's something that's very interesting. I have actually had people come to my office that are already married that say, you know what, I didn't make some decisions before we got married, and so now I want to make sure that this property or this business that I started after the marriage, instead of it being marital property, is actually going to stay my own. Now, that's a tough conversation to have with someone who's already your spouse.
Yeah.
And I don't necessarily think that's a great indicator or a predictor of where the marriage is going.
Mm-hmm.
However, people can do that. You can sign an agreement after you get married that says, even though this would be considered marital property, it's not going to be divided that way at the point that we decide to part ways.
Okay. That's good. And just to kind of finish that point, you can change both a prenup and a postnup later on in the marriage if you want to. Isn't that correct?
If you want to. I mean, that's with basically any contract. If you execute a new or a modification to it, then you can certainly
make changes later on. Okay. Audrey.
Yes.
Can you speak to this a little bit in terms of are there such a thing as relationship type contracts? I mean, not necessarily in a legal sense, but it sounds like maybe in a way some of the tools and techniques and skills that you encourage people to have are in a way not in a legal term, but a, you know, relationship contracts. How do you deal with each other?
I think that, and you know, I see probably because I think particularly in the D.C. area, I know we're talking you're referring a lot to marriage today, but actually in the D.C. area, there are probably more single people than there are married.
Okay.
And there are more people trying to get married, you know. That mm-hmm. is the big focus here, because people come here for careers. Mm-hmm. And they get caught up in the careers, and they look up and realize, oh, my goodness, I have no special person, and I really do want to get married. So then they shift gears and start kind of working on that. And the Internet has, of course, been a big deal for a lot of people who suddenly look up and realize that marriage is something that they haven't focused enough on. But I think if you are working on yourself as an individual, that's always been my mantra. If you work on yourself as an individual, if you're aware of yourself and you are working through many of the basic issues I talked about, which is, of course, just having, being able to accept people. You don't have to be married to somebody, but some people can't accept people who are different, and they're just friends of theirs, you know, colleagues, mm-hmm. that kind of stuff. That helps you to be a more well-rounded person. Being able to have the basic tools that I talked about, you need to have those whether you're married or single. Mm-hmm. And you need to have those whether you're gay or straight, or whether you're elderly or young or any of those things. You still need to have those kinds of tools. Mm-hmm. And I think that if you do, yes, I think people make have nonverbal contracts with each other, probably.
Okay, that's a good way of putting it.
On that level, they meet someone, and then there's a lot of assumptions that takes place about that person and what they're going to be able to have in a relationship with them, and vice versa. That's what I call a nonverbal contract. It hasn't been said, but it's assumed that we're going to be together, you know, as a permanent fixture. And then if you're single, you may have many relationships before you find, I use the quote a lot in my office, you will kiss a lot of frogs before you find your prince. And so each time you meet someone, that doesn't necessarily mean that that's going to be the one. These days, a lot of people are meeting their soulmate much later in life. And we haven't talked about seniors, but a lot of times when people downsize, let's say they widow or divorce, downsize, move out of a house, move into senior living, and they're around more people their age, and they meet a partner.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That is so common, and it happens a lot.
Yeah.
And it may be that during their 40s and 50s, they were single, and there wasn't, you know, anybody in their mm-hmm. life, but they hit 60, or older, and they meet someone. So this is not, I guess it's not written in stone in terms of these tools, but regardless of what your age, you need to be a lot more aware. I think what we talked about previously also, Ethel, was that a lot of the very young people, I think like high school, college age in particular, they're not particularly interested in a special person. They kind of do what they call hooking up. And it's meeting somebody out at a party or at a club or something on that order, and you get together with a group, and it's almost like group relating. And you have a good time, and you know, you listen to some music, you dance, and da 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 da, and that's kind of, so it's a different kind of relating, but that's another form.
That's another form of relationship.
Yeah. Different depending on where you are and who you are.
Right. Let me take a moment right here and let Michelle say something, because I think she wanted to kind of add something to the conversation when we were talking a little earlier. Yes.
Sure. Well, today is Valentine's Day, right?
It is.
So there's tons of people thinking about it, love, getting engaged, and things of that nature.
Yeah.
And so one of the reasons why I recommend putting your agreement down in writing in the context of a prenuptial agreement is because money, and specifically habits about money, are one of the leading causes for people's marriages ending up in divorce or resulting in divorce. And so some of the things, you need to have some hard conversations before you get to that point with your partner about, you know, is someone a saver? Is someone a spender? You know, what's your vision for the future? Are you planning for retirement currently? Mm-hmm. Are you sort of living in the moment? And so it's habits about money that really cause, I think, the demise of a lot of relationships and also financial deceit. So you want to make sure that you're engaging in these conversations where there's full financial disclosure, from the beginning.
Right.
And meeting with either a counselor or a lawyer to sort of talk through these issues mm-hmm. from the beginning will help save some of
save
these
a whole lot of marriages,
save a whole
right,
lot of
right.
heartache and money down the road. And that's
yeah.
what you ultimately
yeah.
want to do
yeah.
is you know, be and responsible.
Can you also speak, Michelle, while you're talking to Audrey's statement that a lot of seniors are marrying or are falling in love? Because I'm seeing it also when you have people who have already either been married and or have had adult children
right.
and have significant property.
Right.
And then they get together with somebody else who probably does too. From a
right.
legal perspective, give us some insight on what's involved there.
Right. I find it's almost more important or at least equally important for persons who are more senior, whether it's their second, third, you know, marriage, something like that, to make sure that you have a prenuptial agreement. Because what I've seen in my practice is that a lot of times when more senior persons come in to discuss getting married, it's their adult children that fuel the disputes between the parties. Because then if they're expecting a certain inheritance or something,
yeah,
a piece of property
mama's house
has been set
or
aside
daddy's house,
them,
uh-huh.
and then suddenly this other
person
walks
comes in.
And
yeah.
then that changes things a little
uh-huh.
bit, and that changes the
uh-huh.
dynamic. And so I've seen persons even in their 70s and 80s, quite frankly,
oh, yeah.
where the adult children are fueling vicious, you know, battles back and forth or fueling
oh,
divorces.
That's sad.
It actually is sad when I have seen that. But so it becomes even more important to set aside whatever property you have for your children and make sure that your spouse is knows what they're going to get and that your children's inheritances are protected
yeah,
as well.
That's important.
Yeah.
And I would think, Audrey, I want you to kind of chime in on there. If those things are in place, from an emotional point of view, it would help the relationship, don't you think? I mean, am I right in saying that? If you've made financial provisions and legal provisions, wouldn't that kind of help the relationship?
Oh, of course it would. It would help not just the relationship between the two people. It helps the extended family as well. It helps everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, there's no doubt about it. I was thinking about it as you all were talking. People tend to see people like me before they see would see Michelle probably
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
they're trying to avoid divorce.
Mm-hmm.
so,
mm-hmm.
by the time,
mm-hmm.
so when they come in to see me, they're hoping to stay out of that realm.
Right.
I think she's right. If they've done prenup and whatever, then they at least feel secure about you know, not having to worry if it ends up in a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
But generally, when they come in, they have already entertained the idea that if sometimes they say you're our last hope, we've gone to the pastor, we've gone here, we've taken a seminar, we're trying to stay out of the courtroom,
mm-hmm.
but we know that if we don't make it here, the next place we're going to go is to see a lawyer, and very often I am referring them to if it you know looks like it's not going to work to an attorney, and of course I refer a lot to Michelle.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and thank you, Audrey. Appreciate it.
But I think that most of the time, people by the time they get to me, they realize that they are missing a lot of these tools and skills, and if only they had them in the beginning, as much as they. Put a focus on planning the wedding, you know, more time on the wedding than they do on these basic skills that they need to have so that they can keep the relationship together. And
mm-hmm.
most people just don't do that. A lot of people don't do they don't do the clinical pre-marriage counseling. They will go in and take a course, or they'll see the pastor, which is the religious
mm-hmm,
end, but
mm-hmm,
not
mm-hmm.
not the layman's end. And
yeah.
I think I have always recommended that you do both.
Yeah.
I don't think you do one without the other.
Yeah. When I talked to Michelle about this program the first time, you mentioned planning the marriage.
Right.
I thought that was a great idea. That just, you know, if you spend as much time planning the marriage as you plan the wedding.
Right.
That would be tremendously helpful.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah. We're talking to Dr. Audrey Chapman. Let me give you their contact information if you would like. Dr. Chapman's website is audreychapman.com. She's on Twitter at AudreyChapman13 and on Facebook, The Audrey Chapman Show. Her phone numbers are 703-914-2068 and 202-756-5042. Attorney Michelle C. Thomas can be reached. Her website is thomaslawdc.com. Her phone number is 202-536-4841. She's on Twitter at Michelle C. Thomas and on Facebook at Michelle C. Thomas. And we are talking with both of them here on Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. So you think you're in love. Are you ready for the twists and the turns? Audrey, tell us a little more about the kinds of techniques and tools and how, as a practical matter, you see them playing out in the various age groups. You were starting to talk about young people, hopefuls, as you call them, when you and I spoke. Tell us a little more about them and the relationship issues you see among married people and so forth like that.
Well, I guess because I've gone through several developmental phases in terms of my age, I'm really very concerned about the young people because they don't appear to really, and maybe this is just kind of where they are right now, but I think technology plays a big role in it. They don't do a lot of face-to-face relating, you know, like very intimate relating. It's either, you know, relating over texting is obviously a very big deal, and or like I said, group relating. And I've talked to a couple of my friends who work at universities with students, and that is one of the things they've observed also. So we are frequently, me and my colleagues are talking about what kind of individuals are they going to make when they have to figure out how to have an intimate relationship with another person. One of the things I work a lot on when people come in, and this is sometimes long after they are engaged, maybe they're just engaged, or maybe they're trying to decide whether they should get engaged, or maybe they are also married, but is looking at and doing a good assessment of what the real issue is. And generally what it is they haven't connected. There's no connection between them. Yes, they've established a home. Sometimes they have children. So, and they may be married or not married, by the way, because a lot of people are also, I don't know if you know this, but the stats on people living together has really gone up. And so there are a lot more people living together and choosing not to get married. And that's another trend that's going on in the U.S.,
yeah, and that has some legal implications, too.
And that has some legal implications.
Yeah, yeah.
And so a lot of people don't even know what it's like to be emotionally intimate. They've been sexual, but they don't know anything about emotionally connecting to each other. And that is really the glue that holds any long-term relationship together. So if you don't know what that looks like and you don't know how to do it and you've never experienced it yourself, and you're groping and trying to figure it out, or you're trying to cover it up by buying a lot of fancy things for the family, taking them on fancy trips, making a lot of money, being a good provider, you know, all of that kind of stuff. But the relationship is empty, and this is what I hear over and over and over again. It's empty. I can't find the person. They don't mean that they don't see them visually, but they can't find them emotionally, and vice versa. The second thing, because if that's going on, then I know the second thing is already happening, which is that people aren't being faithful. We haven't talked about that at all this morning. If they're single, then there's cheating going on the side. And if they're married, there are definitely affairs. And I'm not just talking about the men. The women have almost as many affairs now as the men do.
Wow, really?
And so, yes. And so I see a lot of that showing up on my doorstep as well.
Wow.
And these are some of the issues that happen when you haven't really done the homework around how do you relate to another human being? How do you stand tall? How are you able to be communicative, not just words, but how do you speak in a genuinely honest and open way where you're transparent? And I use transparency a lot when I'm talking to a couple. How do you face anger? How do you work through anger? Because a lot of people avoid it or try to avoid it.
Mm-hmm.
How do you stand in it? How do you stand tall in it and work it through and work it to the point of resolution?
Mm-hmm.
This is what makes for a solid relationship.
Mm-hmm.
This
mm-hmm.
is what helps people to trust each other.
That's huge. That is absolutely huge.
And of course, I would say, certainly in my practice, infidelity is a large part of it.
Really?
But I would say it does go back to, again, not doing the work in the beginning, because oftentimes there are signs, right? So even if you're having a discussion about finances before the marriage, for example, and someone hasn't been fully forthcoming, well, you know that there's a greater likelihood that that person is going to engage in some sort of deceptive behavior down the road.
If they're deceiving you about money right now.
Right,
yeah.
And then you have a lot of couples getting married because they're succumbing to pressure, societal pressure, or because they've reached a certain age and they're not willing to actually wait for the person that is actually for him or her.
Mm-hmm.
And so ultimately it does lead to adultery and infidelity and just in relationships that are not based upon respect nor based upon love. And that's what's absolutely necessary in order to stay out of my office, ultimately, at the end of the day.
Uh-huh. And there's another piece, too. I don't know if you see it or not, Michelle, but a lot of people feel they have to get married because they've gotten pregnant. And they feel like, now I need to go ahead and make this thing happen. And deep down inside, I know this person isn't for me. I know we really don't have what it takes. But now we have this child coming, and we've got to make this thing. We've got to bring this thing off. And that, again, might be family pressure or societal pressure or even pressure from the church. Whatever it is, they feel like they need to move forth with this thing.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I do think that that trend is starting to subside a bit because the stigma attached, I think, to single mothers or single parents, I think, has decreased over the years. So
it's not as bad as it used to be.
I haven't seen it in my office.
Really? Oh, that's interesting.
No, not at all. And I'm not talking about 20-year-olds either. I'm talking about much older people that are finding themselves in these situations. Yeah, it's just... I don't know, it's very perplexing sometimes because you wonder, how did you get yourself in this kind of a situation?
Mm-hmm.
And now people think of counselors anyway, I guess, as the cleanup people, you know, clean up my life, clean up my mess.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they show up with these very, very challenging, I guess, situations that they haven't thought through very well. And now they want somebody else to kind of fix it, basically.
Yeah, I think the bottom line is people are getting married for too many of the wrong reasons, and they're not thinking about the seriousness, the legal implications, consequences that when you marry this person, you're taking on their, you know, whether it be their credit score, maybe you can't buy a home or acquire a home because someone had a poor credit score. I mean, there are a lot of things that become joined when you actually say, I do. And so it really requires a much deeper level of communication, like Audrey was saying, and an almost investigation into who the person really is.
Yeah, yeah. You need to know that.
Do you think it's horrible, Michelle, if people get credit background and all that kind of stuff on a person?
Listen, Audrey, I think, you know, with the engagement ring should come a credit report. I think it's absolutely necessary.
Before the engagement ring,
credit reports need to be exchanged.
My goodness.
And I have a lot of people now that actually Google the person to try to see if there's anything.
Right.
And there are some sites now where you can even find out whether they have a criminal record or any of that kind of stuff. And, I mean, it's sad that one has to go through all of that, but particularly if you've met the person online, you don't know as much about them.
I've seen that in my practice even worse. Couples that have met online, what I've seen, and I don't know, Audrey, if you know, I've seen this as a trend, but a lot of times one of the spouses actually, they don't actually stop their online activity even after they get married, and so they may continue to maintain a profile and ultimately engage, which ultimately leads to infidelity at some point down the road. And so while I think, you know, online dating is certainly a respectable avenue, you really want to be careful.
Be careful.
I've seen a definite trend where one person doesn't quite give up that, right, that online,
right,
presence. So.
And I know when I used to do family law, I would tell people, especially, well, anybody, that if the person says that they had been married and that they were divorced, they want to see the divorce decree.
Yeah.
Okay?
That, yes,
I mean,
absolutely.
You want to see the actual divorce decree.
Absolutely.
Because I've seen too many situations where the person said they were divorced and they weren't.
Yeah, I've seen
they
that
spent
well.
A long-term marriage together. They die, and here comes the person from the first marriage.
Absolutely.
Okay? So that's really, really critically important.
And it's important for from
and it's a public
pension,
record.
For public records, right, but from, you know, pensions.
Pensions, everything.
Comes to
estate,
collect,
yeah. You know, you can't be a little bit married, and either
right.
you are divorced or you're not, you
right.
know?
Right.
So, and on the estate planning side, there are a lot of things that we can do to help people who may have children by different people and want to take care of them. You know, a lot of clients will come in and that's their situation, and I can help them by preparing trust that will arrange for the money for one child or a child that may not be by their spouse. To be managed, their money can be managed by somebody entirely outside of the marriage, and then the children in the marriage can be handled by the spouse who's in the marriage. And that way you don't have all that drama that, you know, you can right. avoid all that drama that would happen otherwise.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. But let's get back to the twists and turns of being in love. Audrey, talk to us a little bit more about seniors, because we have a lot of seniors. I'm starting to see it even in my practice where people are bringing their parent. It's usually the child bringing the parent saying, my mother or my dad is about to get married or they're dating, and I want to make sure they are protected, you know. Mm-hmm. And so tell me a little bit more from first the relationship side, what you're seeing, Audrey, and then I want Michelle to talk about from the legal side. Just a minute. Daryl's looking at me. We're okay, Daryl? Do we need to take a break? Okay. Audrey, go on. He says you can go on, and then we'll take a break afterwards.
Okay, well, I would say that the bulk of my practice is probably people between the ages of, I'm going to say, 30 and probably 50. Mm-hmm. That's the bulk of the people that I see. And occasionally I do see people who are 60 and older, but they're probably more on the low end, not the high end. Most of the time, if they've been out of a relationship for years, let's say they've been widowed for a very, very long time, they feel rusty.
Mm-hmm.
They are in shock that they have met someone. They didn't anticipate that. They assumed that being in a relationship was pretty much over.
Mm-hmm.
Then they move into senior living, and where there's more social activities going on. You know, they plan a lot of stuff for people in those living situations,
mm-hmm.
and they meet someone. And so now they feel a little awkward, a little rusty. They don't know how to handle dating and whatever, so they want a lot of advice on that. And a lot of times, and this may be shocking to both of you, they also want some advice on intimacy, how to be both emotionally close but also sexual with someone.
Mm-hmm.
You have all of that because, you know, now we have the Viagra.
Oh, Lord.
here. and so there are a lot of those things that come up for them,
mm-hmm.
that they've not faced maybe in years.
Yeah, yeah.
And so there's that kind of stuff. And then, of course, they usually have a very limited income. So they want to know how to navigate that.
Wow.
And is it okay to share the expenses going out? And, you know, those are very
practical things. Yeah.
That's right.
Well, when we come back, we'll talk a little more about that. And Michelle, have you chime in on it
for
us, please? But we have to take a break right now.
1450 WOL, where information is power.
Dear John, I was hoping it wouldn't come to this, but you've left me no choice. I'm leaving. Uncontrolled high blood pressure is really serious, and lately you seem to really not care. I've been there for you since day one, and I know you think I'm going to keep ticking. But no, my friend, I can quit whenever I want. Why can't we get back to the good times? when we were more active and ate more healthy foods, and you checked on me every once in a while. Is that too much to ask? I don't want to leave, but unless you stop ignoring me, what else am I supposed to do? Remember, when I quit, you quit. Sincerely, your heart.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Doing the minimum to control your high blood pressure isn't doing enough. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. Find out how at heart.org/bloodpressure. Check, change, control. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to The Cat Show. Up next, we have Nico. Nico is a member of the Shelter Pet Group.
That's right. A group known especially for their sunspot sleeping, ball chasing, leg rubbing, couch purring, bed leaping, and of course, companionship.
Wonderful. And what breed would you say Nico is?
I'd have to go with a tabbyish Persian kind of mix.
Tremendous cat.
I'd also like to point out her coat's wonderful mix of colors. Is it black, gray, gray-black, brown?
Somewhere in between.
Indeed.
You know, it's always special when we get to see a cat like this.
Just look how she struts.
It's like she owns the place.
And how she's so incredibly cute in her indifference to commands.
A strong-willed feline.
Ah, and see how she curls up and cuddles her person.
The pitch on her purring is simply perfect.
Nice one.
I know. Fantastic cat.
Fantastic indeed. But really the best way to know an amazing shelter pet like Nico is to meet one.
Visit theshelterpetproject.org today. Adopt.
Brought to you by Maddie's Fund, the Humane Society of the United States, and the Ad Council.
I can make an impact in the world. As young people think that we can't make a difference, but not only we can make a difference, but sometimes we can make the biggest difference.
We wanted to be the doers and we wanted to be the changers.
You just have to find something that you're passionate about and use your talents and your abilities to volunteer.
Volunteering doesn't have to be a chore.
It really is a reward in itself.
It helps you get farther in life.
There is no better feeling than helping somebody else.
You could see one person smile. You could tell they needed that smile, and it could really change and open up your heart to new things.
A lot of things are really competitive about individual achievement. Volunteering is a way to take a step back from that.
See a need, gather friends, and change the world.
Changing someone's world.
It happens now. This is the time. And this is when you learn, so why not start?
Are you a young volunteer making a difference? Apply for the Prudential Spirit of Community Award. Visit spirit.prudential.com.
1450 WOL, where information is power.
Welcome back. The time has gone so fast, but just before the break, Dr. Chapman, we've been talking with Dr. Audrey Chapman and attorney Michelle C. Thomas. Dr. Chapman was telling us about seniors who are finding love. And during the break, Michelle was talking to us about something called gray divorce. I'd never heard of that before. What's that?
Yeah, gray divorce is a concept that's evolved, I would say, in the last few years, particularly as the baby boomers have reached the point of, you know, their mid-60s and older. And that's the concept of people in retirement are now getting divorced at increasing rates. And the statistics I read have said that in the last 20 years, that population's divorce rate has actually doubled. And
wow.
So the issues that group of people has to deal with when you're facing a gray divorce, a lot of times relates to your earning potential. So those persons are at the end of their earning capacity. Mm-hmm. Their ability to earn income is reduced or perhaps non-existent.
Mm-hmm.
And you're relying on pensions and Social Security and annuities and retirement and things of that nature. So what do you do, though, if it's a short-term marriage and you're not prepared? And let's say you may not be entitled to alimony or entitled to a significant portion of the other party's retirement or pension or something like that. So what do you do? And so the standard of living for those persons, divorcees in that category, a lot of times decreases upon the divorce. And that's something that you really have to think about and plan for if you're going into a marriage or if you're getting out of a marriage toward, you know, that sort of area of your life.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, I never heard of that. Audrey, is there anything in particular that you would like to share? Because we only have 5 minutes. It's amazing.
Oh,
it's gone so quickly. Is there something that you would like to share in particular?
I do want to kind of put just one last little thing in, which is that I think the biggest reason that people end up at least coming in to see me and probably end up in divorce, is because there really is a lot of bad experiences that they're both having in the relationship. Things like ignoring each other, turning away from each other, tensions, you know, being contentious and stuff. And so as a result of that, they at some point decide after years and years of it, they can't handle it any longer, and they want to leave. I think that when marriages head for divorce, there's a high percentage of those kinds of negative interaction. In other words, criticism, mm-hmm. defensiveness, contempt, all of those things kind of exist. In order for people to be together and have a long-term compatible situation, they have to really want to work together, and they have to be open to accepting that maybe if they're not able to work through, problem solve, and come out with compatible results with each other, that they really need to go and get the tools. There's nothing wrong with that. I think that mm-hmm. we're past the Oprah Winfrey and Phil Donahue and a whole bunch of other people helped us to get past the notion of feeling that it's something shameful when you reach out for help. Mm-hmm. I think it's okay to understand that, that in marriage, it's never going to work if it all has to be your way or his way. It has to be our way. I say that all the time. It's a team effort. It's got to be looked at as a team effort, and you have to be willing to come together to want to do that.
That's great. That is great. You got to be ready for the twists and turns. You really do.
And I do want to mention that every October at Mount Zion Baptist Church in Arlington, Virginia, we do a couples seminar, and it's free, doesn't cost anything. And if people want that information, they go to kballard at mountzionbaptist.com. And it's every October, generally the second weekend. It's always on a Saturday, completely free. It's several hours. You get all kinds of skills, and I mean, where can you go and find something that's free?
Audrey, if you remember to send me an email or some information on it as it gets closer, I would be glad to announce it on the radio program. Okay,
wonderful.
I really would. Thank you.
We will do that.
Yes.
Okay,
Michelle, do you have some last words for us?
Sure. You know, as a divorce lawyer with more than a decade of experience, one of the most common threads I see is essentially a lack of appreciation or gratitude toward the other partner.
Mm.
I see that very often when I listen to stories and clients come in and meet with me and we have consultations, that one party has taken the other party for granted. And that manifests itself a lot of times in infidelity or financial, like I said, deception or spending, excessive spending habits. Mm. And so, but a lot of times a very common thread is not appreciating what you have while you have it. So that's what I would say on this Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
Is appreciate what you have, and then certainly, and do the work, take the proper steps that are necessary. As important as it is to go through premarital counseling, it's equally important to meet with legal counsel.
Yes.
Just to know and make sure that you're protecting yourself and planning responsibly for your life ahead.
Oh, that's great. And plan your marriage. That's
plan your
great,
marriage. Absolutely.
Great advice. I hope
I would say plan your life.
Yeah. Okay. That's
because
even better.
It starts with the individual first, and then I think then you can plan the marriage.
Well, ladies, I really want to say thank you.
Thank you.
This has been a wonderful discussion. So you think you're in love? The twist and turn. I hope my audience has enjoyed it. This is Attorney Ethel Mitchell with Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. Tune in next week, and we are going to do a program that will talk about law and Black history. Rod Boggs of the Washington Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law will be on, and that's going to be a very interesting and informative program. So happy Valentine's Day to everyone. Thank you again, Audrey and Michelle. Thank you all, you both very much. Have a good day. Goodbye, everyone.